The men who play it make it so.
I believe it's about character. It's about who you are, what do you stand for, integrity.
The game is about life, and it's about what you have to do to pick yourself up, to make yourself the best you can possibly be.
I got a scholarship to Nebraska. I had a 17-year career with the Vikings.
It is the ups and downs of the game, the turmoil. Those are all parts of life.
It is my duty, I believe, is to get that message out that you can live with integrity, but you have to have some God in your life to do that.
I've always wanted to be great at everything I've done. I've always been a competitor. I've always showed humility. I'm a team guy.
The values that it teaches you is A, diligence, B, perseverance. There are many more downs than there are ups.
This is such a spectacular game. It's a matter of one's dedication, one's belief in themselves as an individual to achieve greatness.
The game of football has taught me faith, it's taught me commitment, and it's taught me to have a tremendous resolve, and whatever I plan to do, I'm going to get it done.
You never dream, no matter how good you may be, that you'll ever be in the Hall of Fame.
Living with integrity, I certainly, you know, honor the values of the Hall of Fame.
This is an honor bestowed not only on me, but for every teammate that I had. All of these people should be celebrated, not just me. It takes the moment from me to everyone but me.
Honor the heroes of the game.
Preserve its history.
Promote its values.
And celebrate excellence everywhere.
Prior to the 1978 NFL draft, some NFL scouts suggested that since University of Washington quarterback Warren Moon had played in a rollout rather than dropback passing offense, he would be a mid-round pick. Others speculated that since only one African-American quarterback had achieved any measurable success in the NFL, Moon would have to play some other position. Regardless of which misguided reason motivated NFL scouts, Moon remained confident of his abilities and opted to sign with the Edmonton Eskimos of the Canadian Football League. He went on to lead the Eskimos to an unprecedented 5 consecutive Grey Cup victories. Moon returned to the United States to play for the Houston Oilers in 1984. He racked up nearly 50,000 passing yards in 17 NFL seasons. Moon set a new club record with 3,338 yards passing in his first season with Houston, a mark that he would break 4 more times. In 1986, the Oilers installed the run-and-shoot offense. Moon's quarterback skills finally became apparent to all. The wide-open offense showcased Moon's strong arm, running skills, and big play ability. In 1990, Moon led the league with 4,689 passing yards. He also led the league in attempts, completions, touchdowns, and tied Dan Marino with a record 9 300-yard games in a season. The following year, he again led the league in passing yards with 4,690. At the same time, he joined Hall of Fame quarterbacks Dan Marino and Dan Fouts as the only quarterback to post back-to-back 4,000-yard seasons. Moon also established a new NFL record that season with 655 attempts and 404 completions. Despite spending his first 6 professional seasons in the CFL, Moon ranked 3rd all-time in the NFL passing yardage and 4th in touchdown passes thrown at the time of his retirement. He was enshrined in the Pro Football Hall of Fame in 2006. Give it up for Warren Moon! Today's session is moderated by Kenny Rota. Rota currently hosts his own sports talk radio show at 1480 WHBC. He also works as the ringside reporter for the Lake Erie Monsters Hockey on Fox Sports and WUAB TV 43, and as a Browns and Ohio State football analyst for WEWS TV 5, Newsnet5.com. He was voted Cleveland's best sports talker numerous times. Put your hands together for Kenny Rota.
Thank you and welcome to a special edition of a Heart of a Hall of Famer series today as we celebrate Black History Month. And today's focus is on persevering through adversity with Hall of Famer Warren Moon. This will give you students an idea of what Warren had to go through to end up here in Canton, Ohio in the Pro Football Hall of Fame. And it's an amazing story, one that I think will uplift a lot of you as you leave here, finding out what this man had to deal with to reach the greatest level in football history, and that's making it to the Pro Football Hall of Fame. He's also going to discuss some of the things that go into becoming a Hall of Famer, and we always talk about the gold standards of character that make up Hall of Famers: commitment, integrity, courage. I know that's something he had to deal a lot with, respect. He and I talked on my radio show yesterday about that, that was something that was very important to him, as well as excellence. So we'll get into all of those. You're going to have an opportunity to ask Warren some questions coming up here in a little bit. We'll tell you how you will go about doing that. But we want to recognize the schools that are in attendance with us here tonight or maybe joining us at some point here today. McKinley High School from Canton, Ohio is here. Heritage Christian School from Canton, Ohio is with us today. There you go. Campbell Memorial High School will be joining us, I'm guessing, here in a little bit as they're still on their way. Sandusky High School from Sandusky, Ohio. Phoenix School out of Akron, Ohio. Wade Park Elementary School from Cleveland, Ohio. Martin Luther King High Career Campus from Cleveland, Ohio is here today. And we may have a couple of schools joining us via the video conference from Warrensville Middle School in Warrensville, Ohio, and Gregg Elementary School out of Houston, Texas. So if you want to ask a question to our Hall of Fame guest here today, Warren Moon, all we ask is that you get your question ready. We have a microphone set up in the back of the room. You head up to the microphone, speak clearly, loudly into the microphone, state your name, the school you're representing, and then the question that you have for Warren Moon. So we're going to get this started right now. Warren, as I said, you and I talked yesterday on my radio show about the gold standards of character, and the one that you told me that was... they were all important, but the one that stood out to you, maybe the most important, was respect. Right. Give everybody here in the room today and anybody watching online why respect was so important for you.
Well, I think it's important not only to me, but I think it should be important to everyone else to try and gain respect from anybody and anything that you do. And it doesn't mean that you have to be a professional football player or trying to be a quarterback, which is what I was trying to do at a very early age in my career. I had a lot of doors closed in my face when I was a young player. A lot of people didn't think I could play the position, and I just wanted the respect and earn that respect that I could play the position. So respect was something that was always important to me because, like I said, I had so many different pitfalls along the way as far as people telling me, no, I couldn't do it. And when somebody tells you, no, you can't do something, when you know in your heart and your mind that you can, you just want to prove that you can. And so the respect thing was always very important to me, that I wanted to gain that respect that I could play the position, I could play it at a high level, I could do all the different things that people think that I couldn't do. And so respect was one of those words that I always just wanted to try and gain from everybody and everything that I did, because I think as you go through your life, even with your interactions with your friends, I think trying to earn their respect, everybody doesn't have to like you, everybody doesn't have to love you, but you want people to respect what you do, and we want people to respect who you are and what you stand for, and that's what I was all about in my young career. Coming up through the ranks, just trying to earn that respect from everybody. And I think I did that by the time my career was over.
Warren grew up in Los Angeles, correct?
Los Angeles, California.
Father passed away at an early age, working while playing sports at the same time, and You chose one sport. It was football. What was it about football?
Well, I loved all the different sports. Believe it or not, basketball was probably my favorite sport, and I just didn't feel like I was going to be tall enough to play basketball, even though I ended up being 6'3". But I thought if I wasn't at least 6'5", I wasn't going to have a chance to really make it in basketball. Baseball was probably my best sport, believe it or not, but it was a little bit too slow for me. It just didn't invigorate me as much as I wanted to in all the other sports. And football was just something that just kept coming back because of my leadership abilities, because I had a very good arm at a very young age. I found that out when I was 10 years old playing Pop Warner football. And I was put at the quarterback position. And I think because of my upbringing, my father passing away when I was 7, I kind of became the man of the house at a very, very young age. Believe it or not, I had 6 sisters, and it was only me, the only boy, along with my mom. So I was the man of the house at that age, and I think I matured a lot quicker than a lot of kids my age, and I think that helped me as far as going forward and playing the quarterback position, because I had those natural leadership abilities as a young kid. Everybody looked at me as a lot older than what I really was. So I really love the quarterback position because of everything that it entailed, as far as you being the guy that everybody looks to make the big plays, to make the big decisions at the right time. The guy that's leading the football team, the guy that's leading the team by example with all the other things that you do, as far as how much time you work out, how much time you study to get ready for games, things like that. All those things really intrigued me as far as playing quarterback, and that's one of the reasons why I wanted to continue to play the position.
But your road to being a starting quarterback in the NFL, it was a long, bumpy road. A lot of twists and turns, yeah. The journey. And when you were deciding to play football and want to play the quarterback position back in the 70s, there were not a lot of black quarterbacks in the NFL. James Harris comes to mind, right, as the one that stood out with Tampa Bay. When you decided that, okay, this is what I want to do, even though that there aren't a lot of black quarterbacks in the league, take us through that journey, because in high school you were very successful, but you had to go to a junior college before you got interest from a major college and then to the Canadian League before you went to the NFL. So give everybody here in attendance an idea of what that journey was like.
Yeah, like you said, I came up trying to play quarterback in the late 60s, early 70s, and there wasn't a whole lot of role models for me to look forward to as far as guys playing the position at the professional level. Marlon Briscoe was the first African-American quarterback to ever start in an NFL game. But he was the third-string quarterback, and the first 2 quarterbacks got hurt. The only reason why he started was because the first 2 quarterbacks were injured and they had no choice but to start him. So he ended up starting and really did well as a quarterback, has a Denver Bronco, believe it or not, touchdown record that still stands today as a rookie. He threw 15 touchdowns during his rookie year, but the next year wasn't even invited back to the team to play quarterback. So he went on to the Buffalo Bills and became a wide receiver. At the Buffalo Bills was also James Harris playing quarterback out of Grambling, and also Joe Gilliam was playing for the Pittsburgh Steelers at that time. So those were the only 2 quarterbacks I really had to look at as probably role models, somebody that I could say one day if I do everything that I'm supposed to do, maybe I could be at that level. But as I continued to play the game, like you talked about, it was just very increasingly difficult for me to get an opportunity to play the position, because there were so many stereotypes about African Americans being able to play the quarterback position. And I ran into a lot of those stereotypes. One, when I was being recruited out of high school, I was an all-city quarterback in Los Angeles coming out of high school, and I was being recruited by a lot of major colleges, but none of them wanted to recruit me as a quarterback, even though I was an all-city quarterback. They all wanted to change my position to defensive back or to wide receiver. And I wasn't going to have any part of that, because I felt like I could play quarterback in major college. So when I wasn't getting that opportunity to play in major college out of high school, I decided to go to junior college for a year just to see if I could better my opportunities. And I went to junior college for a year at West Los Angeles Junior College, ended up setting a bunch of state records, was all state as a quarterback there. And again, I was being recruited, but again, a lot of schools wanted to look at me as another position. But finally, the University of Washington started recruiting me as a quarterback, and the University of Colorado, and I started getting some opportunities to play the quarterback position coming out of junior college. But I really felt like I didn't have to go to junior college, but that's something that I ended up having to do, just because my journey was a little bit different than most guys, because I was trying to play the quarterback position as an African American.
Do you feel, as we celebrate Black History Month, do you feel like you're the godfather of the African-American quarterbacks? Because today, I think it's four straight Super Bowls. We've had an African-American quarterback in the Super Bowl. This year, of course, Cam Newton. The previous 2 years, Russell Wilson, who won it 2 years ago. So do you take pride in that? Because I know a lot of guys look up to you, and you and other African-American quarterbacks started the Generals Club to be mentors to young African-American quarterbacks.
Yeah, we started a quarterback fraternity called the Field Generals, and it was basically made up of African-American quarterbacks, where younger African-American quarterbacks would have all these older guys who have played the game, gone through a lot of different trials and tribulations throughout our careers, and to teach these young guys how to handle some of the things that they were going to have to go through. I feel like one of the most rewarding things that I got out of my career was trying to help make change at that position. And myself, Doug Williams, winning the Super Bowl in 1988, I think Randall Cunningham, the way he played during his tenure, we were all about the same time. We all played the game at a very, very high level, and I think we opened the eyes of a lot of general managers, a lot of owners, a lot of coaches and scouts around the National Football League that African Americans could play this position and could play it at a high level. And I think we opened up a lot more opportunities for that next generation of African Americans to get a chance to play quarterback, whether it was Rodney Peete or Dante Culpepper or Donovan McNabb, Michael Vick being the number one overall pick in the draft. You had Cam Newton became the number one overall pick just recently, Jameis Winston. So African Americans now are getting the opportunity to play the position at a high level and getting many more opportunities than ever. And I felt like because of my play, because of Randall's play, and because of Doug Williams' play during that era of the middle 80s through the 90s, I think that was the thing that really kind of changed the tide as far as players getting those opportunities. And now I don't even think in football it's looked at as a color anymore. If you can play the position, you're going to get an opportunity to play it, and that's all we ever really wanted.
Are we to that point? Do you really believe that?
I really do.
We shouldn't reference you or anybody else as Black African-American quarterbacks. You're just a quarterback.
That's what I'm hoping, and it's been that way kind of for a while. When Russell Wilson went through the Super Bowl a couple of years ago, and I think it was 2013, it wasn't even referenced during the whole week that he was an African-American quarterback in the Super Bowl, and then the next year as well. This year it came up a little bit more with Cam Newton, only because of his celebrations, and I think it was more of a cultural thing than it was race with Cam Newton this year, that I think everybody understands that he can play the position at a high level, and he's done that. But I think what people had a problem with was they hadn't seen a quarterback that celebrated like he did, that showed personality like he did, and was really a cultural thing, that some of the things that he does with the dancing and the dabbing and all the different things that he does, a lot of people just weren't ready for that. I think it caught him off guard. But I don't think it was more of a racial thing as it was a cultural thing.
And for those of you that don't know this, Warren has been a mentor to Cam Newton. You knew him all the way back when he was in high school and have followed his career and have offered advice throughout his career. What type of a person? We see him on TV. We see the dabbing, and all. Well, what is he like? Not bad, right? What's he like as an individual?
Well, he's everything that you want an individual to be as far as what it takes to be successful in the game. He's a very, very hard worker. You look at him as an athlete, as a physical specimen. I mean, he's got everything that you're looking for. He's 6'5". He's 255 pounds. You just don't see a guy walking around like that can do the things that he can do as a quarterback. So he gives you so many different things that you have to worry about. And when I got a chance to train him coming out of college, he was really raw in a lot of areas because of what he was asked to do in college. He was never asked to take a snap from under center. He was never asked to drop back and throw the football with rhythm. He has this big body that we had to try and get his fundamentals and everything in order. And once we were able to do that, he showed everybody what he could do as a quarterback. He has tremendous work ethic. He always wanted to finish everything we did on a positive note. He comes from a really close-knit family. I spent a lot of time with him and his family throughout that process, and they're very, very close, very, very religious. He's a guy that doesn't really party much. He doesn't drink or anything like that. But he does have a huge personality, and he's a very emotional guy. He's really high-strung when he gets excited, and he also gets very low, as we saw after the Super Bowl. He has a tough time dealing with losing. So those are things I think that he can improve on. But if that's the worst thing that the kid has ever done is celebrating after a touchdown or not being excited because of a loss, I think there's a lot of other worse things that he could be doing in his life right now than those two things that he's being criticized about.
And that kind of ties into today's topic as we celebrate Black History Month, persevering through adversity. Yeah, these are things that happen throughout life, whatever it may be, whether it's in school, your job, whatever that job may be, in sports. And I want to go back to when you played at Washington. You're coming out of Washington. NFL teams are looking at you, but not as a quarterback. And you said, I'm a quarterback. I want to play quarterback. So you decided to go to Canada to play quarterback. And you spent 6 years there, won 5 Grey Cup championships in the 6 years. What did that part of your career mean to you?
Well, first of all, going back into the college part of it, here I was a senior at the University of Washington. I was the Pac-8 Player of the Year. We went to the Rose Bowl. I was the Rose Bowl's most valuable player. And here I wasn't even getting an opportunity to go to an NFL camp and show what I could do as a quarterback. Again, people are telling me, we want you to change positions. And I was very, very bitter at that time, just because as a young kid, that was one of my dreams, was to play in the National Football League. And I felt like I had done everything to at least get an opportunity to play. I wasn't asking anybody to guarantee me a position on a team or anything like that. I just wanted a chance to go into a camp, show I could play quarterback, and then if I couldn't play, put me somewhere else, or I can make a decision whether I'm going to continue to play or not. But I wasn't even getting that opportunity. So that really made me bitter about the league. And I knew that it was going to be difficult, but I still thought at some point, because of what I had done in college, I would get a chance to do it, and it didn't happen. The Canadian Football League was giving me that opportunity to play quarterback. Hugh Campbell, who was the coach up there at that time, he said I could be a big-time quarterback, and he believed in me. And I went ahead and took that opportunity to play in Canada just because I was going to be able to play the position that I always wanted to play. And it didn't matter if there was a league in Siberia. I would have went there and I would have played if they gave me the chance to play quarterback. So I ended up going to Edmonton, Alberta, a place that I had never heard of, had never been to before. I took a trip up there. I mean, it was like minus 30 degrees up there when I went on my trip. There was snow up this high on the ground. And I'm wondering to myself, is this something that I should do? But I was going to stick to my guns because of my commitment to the position. The fact that I was trying to gain that respect that we all talk about, and I was getting an opportunity, and that was the biggest thing, getting the opportunity to play a position regardless of where it was. I was going to take that opportunity, I was going to make the most of it I could, and if I ever got the chance to come back to play in the National Football League, I was going to hopefully be ready to do that.
You play 6 years, you win 5 Grey Cups. The leadership part of that, you talked about as a young boy, you had to be the man of the house, and now you're going to another country playing a different type of game. It's still football, but there are different rules, bigger field, 12 men, motion, all that. So you're going there, the leadership aspect of it. Did it take long for your Canadian teammates to recognize you as the leader? Was that something that you had to earn their respect over a couple of seasons? Did it happen right away? Take me through that.
Well, when I went up there, there was mainly a veteran football team, so I didn't have to go in there and try and be the leader. I didn't have to try and be the focus of the team. I was able to be brought along slow. There were other leaders on the team that took over that mantle, and I just had to learn the game, learn the different style of play up there. And I think guys could see by the way I played in practice that this guy can play the game. So you earn respect by the way you carry yourself, by the way you perform, by the way you work, and all those different things. You don't necessarily have to do it with a lot of talk, but you do it with action. And that's the way I've always kind of carried myself. I'm not a guy that boasts a lot. I'm not a guy this emotional guy that's going to give you pep talks all the time or whatever. But I will show you that I'm capable of doing the job by the way I carry myself, by the way my work ethic is, by how much time I put in the building, and then by how I perform on the field. So once people saw that, I gained that respect, and then I went on the field and did the job, and we had a lot of success. And at one time, I thought I was going to play my whole career in Canada. That's how much I really enjoyed it, because I was never judged up there you know, by the color of my skin. I was only judged by how well I played. And it was a very refreshing situation to be involved in, given what I had to face at times when I was in college. Because during some of my college days, there was a lot of booing, a lot of hatred being spewed at me, especially personally, again, because of the color of my skin that I had to deal with. And it was very nice to go through a situation in Canada where you didn't have to deal with that as much. So having the success that I had up there, especially so quick and so early, that was the only reason why I decided to come back and play in the National Football League, was because I did everything up there that I could possibly do in the first 5 years. You know, I was MVP of the league a couple of times. We won 5 championships in a row. Really wasn't a whole lot left for me to do. And in the back of my mind, I'm still thinking, I can play in the National Football League. I think I'm good enough, but until I actually get a chance to do it, I'll never really know, because you never really know how good you are until you go up against the best. And the best players were in the National Football League, no question about it. So I had some opportunities to come back and play in the NFL at this time, believe it or not, as a quarterback. I finally earned that respect from the NFL, and all these teams now wanted to bid for my services to come back to play in the National Football League. So I started to go on my little tour to see exactly where I wanted to play.
Why the Houston Oilers? What was it about the Oilers?
I thought going to Houston, for one, it was a team that was going to be rebuilding. They were a 2-14 team the year before I got there. And they actually hired my Canadian Football League coach to coach there as well, which was something that kind of appealed to me, because now I'm going from Canada to the United States. A lot of people didn't know exactly who I was. I had been gone for 6 years. You wanted to go somewhere where somebody was going to have faith and confidence in you, and that had been through some tough times with you, just in case you had some tough times there. So having a coach who understood me, who had been through winning and losing with me, and knew exactly, you know, what my demeanor was in that, I thought it was would make it much more of a easier transition. And then also they were offering me a heck of a lot of money. That had a lot to do with it as well. So going down to Houston, I also knew I was going to the South. And in the South, a lot of those same feelings and thoughts about African Americans could possibly raise their head again. So I was aware of that as well going into that decision.
It took a lot of courage, another one of our gold standards of character, to make that decision, not only to come back to the NFL, but to go to Houston in the South. What was it? What was the reaction in Houston when you decide to go play for the Oilers, and then you start to develop? You lose some games at the beginning, but then you start winning, and the back and forth with that.
Yeah, it was. People were excited when I first signed to go down there, because the team, like I said, hadn't been very good for a couple of years. That was during, I think, Earl Campbell's last couple of years there, and Bum Phillips. I think he was not the coach anymore. He had gone on to New Orleans, but we didn't win very much the first year or so, because we just weren't very good, and we were trying to build up our talent. We were a very young team, trying to rebuild everybody through the draft, and I took a lot of criticism for that, and I had no problems dealing with the criticism, because as a quarterback, you know that you're going to deal with the criticism. You're going to get more than you deserve sometimes, but you're also going to get more praise sometimes when the team is doing well. So that's just kind of comes along with the job. But it became a lot more personal with me, with the fans, and some of the things that I was hearing, some of the things that my family had to deal with in the stadium during games, during the week, maybe at school, with different kids teasing and fans calling in to talk radio shows, and just some of the different racial overtones that I had to deal with through that time. It was a very difficult time, not so much for me as it was for my young kids, because I had a family at this time. And I had gone through it before already in college, so I could deal with it a little bit better. But now all of a sudden you have young kids who you're trying to explain to them what these names that people are calling their dad are, and they don't understand why where this is coming from, why it's coming. And you have to take off your football hat and now become a dad and explain these things to your young kids and make them feel comfortable when they go to school every day or when they come into the stadium every week, that this is an environment that might be pretty tough for them at times, but hopefully we'll get through this if we just keep persevering. And that's what it was all about, was persevering through this and getting to a point where we finally started winning. And once you start winning, it seems like a lot of those feelings tend to go away. It's amazing how that happens, that nobody hates you anymore once you start winning football games. But it was a difficult time for those first couple of years. But once we started getting to the playoffs and becoming a perennial playoff football team, a lot of that stuff went away. That doesn't mean that those feelings inside of people went away. They just didn't voice them as much, because there really wasn't a reason for you to voice negative feelings if a team is winning.
If anybody has a question you'd like to ask Hall of Famer Warren Moon, please step up to the microphone. Again, state your name, the school you represent, speak clearly and loudly, and your opportunity to talk to a Pro Football Hall of Famer here in Warren Moon. Go ahead.
My name is Jayana Tyler, and I go to Camp McKinley High School. My question for you today is, what kind of character traits have you tried to instill in your children?
Character traits. I think one of the big things I wanted them to always understand is they could be anything they wanted to be in life if they're willing to put the work in. If they're willing to have a passion for what it is they want to do, if they have a love for whatever it is they want to do, and then they have to make sure they have the work ethic in order to make that happen. So work ethic was something that I always tried to instill in them, that as long as you put in hard work, you were going to get the results from it. And they used to watch me train all the time. I had a gym in my house that I trained in every day in the off season. They used to, you know, go off and watch me sometimes when I went to the high school and worked out on the field or whatever it might have been. So they always saw me as a guy that put the work in, and that's why I got the results that I got from playing the game. So part of the character that I wanted them to get out of growing up was making sure you put in hard work. Through that hard work, you're able to accomplish the things that you want to accomplish, whatever goals that you have in life are, because goals were always huge to me as well. And I always felt like you couldn't accomplish anything unless you establish goals at certain times, whether it was your immediate goals, your intermediate goals, and then your long-term goals. And how do you go about getting those? And part of that was putting together a plan. So we always sat down, and if it was one of my kids that wanted to be involved in a sport or if they wanted to do something in school, we sat down and we developed a plan on how we were going to accomplish that. So that was another thing that I always tried to instill in them, was going about a process on how you got to do everything. You don't just blindly go into anything. You try and sit down, put together a plan on how you're going to go about accomplishing what it is you're trying to go after.
Thank you for your question. Very
Thank
good.
Thank you.
Next question, please step up to the microphone. Again, your name, the school you represent, and your question for Warren Moon.
My name is Ethan Collins from McKinley High School, and my question is, what about Cam Newton made you want to mentor him coming out of Auburn?
You know, I met Cam Newton at a football camp that I was having at Disney World when he was in high school, and his dad brought him there to get some instruction from me and also from Doug Williams, James Harris, and also Marlon Briscoe, who was there. And I knew this kid had an ability to be great one day because of his raw physical ability. And I told him if he just keeps working on his fundamentals, putting in the work, that he had a chance to really be good. He did those things, had a great high school career, went to the University of Florida. He got in some trouble there early, so he had to go to junior college, and then he came to Auburn and ended up winning a national championship. And that's when his dad called me after his year in college to train him. When I got a chance to sit down and talk to him, I had heard all these different things about him, whether it was good or bad, but I wanted to hear for myself, and I talked to him about what his goals were, what he wanted to accomplish. And then I talked to a lot of people that were around him. I talked to his teammates, I talked to his coaches, and I got a good feeling about who this kid was. And then, like I said earlier, I got a chance to be around him and his family and see his family environment. And I knew how his dad had pushed him. I knew how his mom was a very nourishing woman, a very religious woman as well. So all these different reasons were reasons why I wanted to be involved in this career, because I believed in him. And I believe that he could be a great quarterback in the National Football League if given the right instruction and if, you know, just given the right mentorship. So he's done everything that you could ask a quarterback to do, and that's one of the reasons why he's one of the top quarterbacks in the league today. Maturity is something that comes at different stages and different levels with all of us, and there's some things I think he still needs to mature about, and I think he will. But as far as what it takes to be great in this league, I think he's willing to put in the work to do all those things, and that's one of the reasons he's having the great success that he's having so far.
Thank you for your question.
Thank you.
Next question. Step on up to the microphone. Don't be bashful. Don't be shy. You know, it's not every day you get to talk to a Pro Football Hall of Famer here, so take advantage of it as you're on this field trip. Go ahead.
My name is Corey Hoskinson. I go to Sandusky High School. My question is, what do you think is the most important piece of advice you have given Cam Newton and Russell Wilson, and have they put it to use?
I think the most important thing I've given them, and you've heard me say this a million times, is you got to put the work in. When you're the quarterback of a football team, you know, leadership has a lot to do with that position, especially when you're a young guy. Russell Wilson came in competing for the number one job as a rookie. When you come in as a rookie, and Cam Newton was the same way, he was the number one overall pick, everybody expected him to be the starter as a rookie, because when you're the number one overall pick, you're going to be asked to play right away, if not the first game of the season, somewhere in that first year. So you've got to gain the respect of all these veteran players who are sitting there wondering how good this guy really is, what is he going to do to differentiate himself from the other quarterbacks that we already have. And the thing that you can do is you put that work in the building. Be the first guy in the building in the morning. Be the last guy there to leave. When guys see you working like this and see you as the quarterback putting in this much time, it's going to make other guys follow, and it's going to make other guys say that this guy really wants to be, you know, our starting quarterback, because he's willing to put all the work in the film room, on the field during practice, on the field after practice, on the field before practice, film room after practice, all the different things that it takes to be great. If you're a young player, you need to do these things. So those are the things I tried to tell these guys what to do. And if you're willing to put that time in to go along with your physical skills when you do get on the field, these guys will see that you're a talented player, but they'll also see that you're a talented player that wants to put the time in to be better than what you really are. That's when you gain the respect of the veteran players on your football team, and that's how you make that transition easier for you to be a starter on that team as a young player. So that's the thing I tried to tell these guys when they first came into the league.
Thanks for your
Thank
question.
You.
Let's go to our video conference. We have a school, Warrensville Heights Middle School, joining us, and they've got a question for you, Warren. So go ahead with your question.
Hi, my name is James Robinson Garcia, and my question was, when you got to the NFL, what was your main goal?
When I got to the NFL, my main goal, again, was to earn the respect of not only my teammates, but also the other players in the National Football League, that I could play the game at a very, very high level. I wanted to win. There's no question about it. I came to a football team that wasn't a winner, that hadn't been a winner for a while, and I wanted to do whatever I possibly could to help that team win. So I felt like if I played the game the way I knew how to play it, I would gain the respect of my teammates, I would gain the respect of players around the league, but we also would be winning, and that would... That was something that was a big goal of mine, to kind of change the whole dynamic of the Houston Oilers football team from a losing football team into a winning football team. That was my main goal.
Thanks for your question.
Thank
we'll
you.
Go to another question in the back of the room. Go ahead.
My name is Javez Alexander, and I attend Sandusky High School. And my question is, how does your off-the-field adversity impact your character?
How does my off-the-field...
Adversity.
You know, I think it really taught me a lot about myself, the adversity that I went through. It taught me a lot about who I was as a person. It taught me a lot about toughness, being able to get through adversity, being able to persevere through that adversity. And it's not something that's easy either. It's not a great feeling to know that, you know, certain people don't like you because of maybe the color of your skin, or think that you're not, you know, smart enough, or think you don't have the intellect to play a position, don't think you have leadership skills, don't think you can learn a pro-style offense. All the different things that they used to say about African Americans, it's not something that you know, makes you feel good, and it kind of hurts your self-esteem at times. But I had tremendous confidence in myself. I also had a tremendous support system with my mom and different people around me, different coaches that I had played for that believed in me. So even though I got a lot of negativity out there from a lot of people, I also had people that were pushing me and supporting me. And I think through that adversity, you don't always have to feel like you're alone. You know, you can feel like even though things are tough, I'm not getting the opportunities I want, doors are being closed in my face, but you also have people that are continually pushing you and telling you that you can do it, you can do it. And I also had my own abilities that said I can continue to do it. And as long as I didn't give up, as long as I kept striving to be better and not get down on the fact that things weren't going exactly at the pace that I wanted them to, I felt like I always had a chance. So my whole philosophy was, as long as I continue to work and improve, one day one of those doors is going to open. And when one of those doors opens, I want to be ready to jump through it and be prepared.
Thank you for your question. Thank you. Along those lines of adversity, we have a video clip here I'd like for the guys to roll right now. We talk about facing adversity on and off the field. You finally get to the NFL, and then all of a sudden you face some adversity when you get benched. So if we could roll the videotape here and everybody take a listen to this.
Warren, will you stop and give us a second? Will you stop and give us a second?
Just 1 second. Two questions.
Really hot in your face.
One comment.
Wait for an off-road quarterback to act, or what do you think?
Warren Moon had overcome much to reach his NFL status. Never had he been faced with being a second-string quarterback.
He just wasn't playing well. The team was not winning. They were 1-4.
I'm running out of excuses. I really am.
Everybody thought that he wasn't good enough. He had nothing left in the tank.
The frustration on Warren Moon's face was palpable. You could see it. And to be in that situation where people didn't respect his gifts and his talent, that put him in a tough spot.
Are you going to the bench this Sunday? That's hard for me to say, but that certainly is a possibility.
Jack called me into his office, and I was a little bit surprised. And he told me he was going to make the change, and he was very nervous telling me that, too. I knew Jack, and I know he's a guy that doesn't like a whole lot of confrontation. And I didn't want to make him feel any more uncomfortable than he was, but I was very, very disappointed.
Benched by your head coach. Here you are. You achieved everything you achieved in the Canadian Football League. You established yourself in the NFL. Off to a slow start. Must be the quarterback's fault. So you get benched. And we saw some of it there. What was that like going through it? And how did you get through it?
Yeah, it was very difficult because here I was. I had gone to 6 straight Pro Bowls at that time in my career. We got off to a slow start, no question about it. I wasn't playing as good as I possibly could, but a lot of other guys weren't playing as well either. But like I talked about earlier, sometimes the quarterback is going to get a little bit more of the blame than what he deserves, and sometimes he's going to get a lot more of the praise than what he deserves. And in this particular situation, I was kind of the scapegoat that said, if we maybe change the quarterback position, maybe that's going to give us a spark and get our team going in the right direction. It was a tough pill to swallow for me, no question about it, because I had never been a backup pretty much in my career. Again, I had been a really good player in the league for a long time, and now all of a sudden I'm on the bench, and I think at that time I was about 38 years old, 37 years old. So I think a lot of people were starting to think my best years were behind me, maybe they want to make that change to a younger quarterback and make that transition. So it was very difficult for me because I knew I was as good a player or better than the guy that they were going to replace me with, and I knew I still had a lot of good football left in me. But that's one of those situations that you almost have to persevere through it, and you have to find out who you are inside and not let it get you down. So the main thing I wanted to do was make sure I did whatever I could for the football team and not let them know that this bothered me as much inside as it really did, that I was going to be a team player, that I was going to help the guy who was going to start as much as I possibly could, get ready for the game, and then once the game started, be his eyes and ears on the sideline to help him, because that's going to help the football team. It was a very difficult situation to be involved in, but I did it. But I ended up getting back on the field in that same football game, believe it or not, The quarterback at that time, his name was Cody Carlson, got injured in that football game. I went back into the game in the first half. We ended up winning the game. I played really well in that game, and we went on and won 11 straight games to finish the season. It ended up 12-4. So It was one of those seasons, and it was one of those situations in my career where if I wouldn't have handled it with a positive attitude the way I did, who knows what might have happened. But it just goes to show that when things do get down, as long as you continue to stay positive, as long as you continue to work, you never know when that opportunity might come again where that whole situation can turn and become a very positive situation for you. And that's exactly what had happened for me. I was only on the bench for a half of a football game. Next thing you know, I'm back out there and doing my thing again and went on to have another Pro Bowl season.
As we continue to talk to you, and I chatted with you yesterday on the radio and I'm listening to you today, you have faced more adversity than most, I think, players at the quarterback position have throughout their career. And where's the inner strength come from that enabled you to overcome all these different types of adversity from when you were in high school through junior college, the CFL, and in the NFL?
I think it comes from my mom. I really do. She was a very, very, or is a very, very strong woman. You know, her birthday is this weekend. I'm flying to California today to spend the weekend with her to celebrate her 88th birthday coming up this weekend. And I used to watch her after my dad passed away. She went back to school. She re-educated herself, became a private duty nurse. She used to work two shifts every day in order to, you know, make enough money to raise all these kids that she had. I watched how she made every penny count in our house. We always had hot meals on the table. We always had clean clothes. I never felt like I was poor at any time in my life, even though, you know, we weren't well off at all, because we were always provided for. And she made lots of sacrifices in her life in order for me to be able to play sports, because it was expensive to play sports. You gotta have equipment, you know, football shoes and pads and all the different things that it takes to play the different sports. She always made those things available to me. And just watching her and the way she made everything work in my house, I think that's where the strength came from. And I think that's where the giving inside of me came from as well, because I have a really giving spirit as far as who I am as a person. So my mom is probably my biggest inspiration and my biggest mentor in my life, and just watching her every day, a lot just rubbed off from her onto me as to where a lot of my toughness came from. And talking about going through perseverance, you know, I was just trying to play a position in a sport. This is a woman who had to take care of a family of seven children and make ends meet, and I thought that was a much tougher tougher hill to climb than what I was trying to go through. So to watch her do that, I felt like what I was trying to do was easy compared to what she went through.
All right, let's see if we have more questions in the back. Again, step up to the microphone, state your name, the school you represent, and go ahead with your question.
I'm Brianna Klink from Heritage Christian School, and my question is, what was your initial thought upon finding out that you were to be inducted into the Pro Football Hall of Fame?
Wow. That was quite a day for me. I remember vividly, you know, where I was, what happened. I was driving with my wife. We were in Detroit at the time where the induction or selections were going to come down. And I was there as part of the Seahawks broadcast team, because we were actually in the Super Bowl, and that's where the Hall of Fame selections come from, the Super Bowl city. So I was involved in a football clinic that morning for kids. I was trying to do whatever I possibly could to keep my mind off of whether I was going to get selected or not, because that was my first year of eligibility. I didn't really know how to handle any of it because I had never gone through that before. People were telling me I had a chance to be selected, and everybody had different opinions, and you just never know, because it's not in your hands anymore as a player. You only can control what you can control on the field. It was now in a bunch of selectors' hands whether I was going to be in the Pro Football Hall of Fame or not. So I remember driving down to the press conference because my presenter had told me there was a good chance that I might be selected because I was in the top eight. They were going to select six, I think, that particular year. And I was very uneasy about going down there, because the last thing I wanted to do was drive down to where the press conference was going to be and then me not get selected, and I would have been totally embarrassed being there and not being selected. So I went back and forth on whether I should even go down there. But finally I decided to go down, and my wife and I were driving, and we were driving down the freeway towards downtown. It was snowing outside, and I got a call from the NFL, believe it or not, that I was trying to get some tickets for a tailgate party for some friends of mine that were coming in for the Super Bowl, and they were calling to tell me that they got these tickets for me. And then at the end of the conversation, the lady on the phone says, "And by the way, congratulations on being selected in the Pro Football Hall of Fame." I'm like, "Nobody's told me that. What are you talking about?" She's like, "I just heard it on television." Next thing you know, my phone beeps over, and it's the Pro Football Hall of Fame calling me to tell me that I had been selected. And I tell you what, it was one of the most emotional moments that I've ever had in my life. I burst into tears. My wife had to take the wheel of the car. I mean, I couldn't even drive the car anymore. And here we are driving down the freeway when this happened. Just all these emotions came out of me of everything that I had gone through. A lot of the emotions came out from other African-American quarterbacks who had played the position before me and during the same time. I felt like this was a little bit of everybody's selection that particular day. So it was a very, very emotional time for me when that happened. And I'll tell you what, one of the most joyous days of my life to hear that news.
Thank you for your question. And as I looked up your numbers, and we hear all about today's current quarterbacks, Cam Newton and some of the young guys that are in the league, Peyton Manning, who just won his second Super Bowl this past year. I combined your Canadian Football League numbers and your National Football League numbers. 70,553 yards passing when you combine the two. 435 touchdown passes when you combine the two. In professional football, when you combine those numbers, that's third all time in both of those categories. When you set out to go to play for the Eskimos in Canada, did you ever imagine that your career would reach those heights, hit those numbers, and that you would end up here in the Pro Football Hall of Fame?
No, and I don't think any player would ever tell you when he goes in to play the game, he expects to be inducted in the Pro Football Hall of Fame when his career is over. If he does, he's a liar, because we looked at the Hall of Famers as people that are like gods, you know? I remember, you know, rooting for all the guys that were in the Hall of Fame as a young kid, whether it was Bart Starr or Roger Staubach or Joe Namath. You never looked at yourself on the same plane as guys like that. All I was trying to do was get a decent career out of professional football, and again, gain that respect that I could at least play and compete on that level with the best players in the world. The rest of it just kind of came and evolved as I continued to improve, as I continued to work. I kept setting goals for myself to try and get better each and every year. I never sat back on my laurels. And I always played the game with a little bit of a chip on my shoulder, because I felt like that, you know, I was always slighted because of the way I had to come through, that I always had to prove myself. And even though I'm playing the game at a high level year after year after year, that chip remained on my shoulder that every year I still felt like I had to prove somebody. And it was kind of a motivator for me. So once I got to the point at the end of my career where people were starting to, you know, talk about Hall of Fame, that was the only time that I ever even thought about it, was when other people brought it up. So for me to get to this level and to achieve this type of honor, it's really, really special. And not so much because of the football part of it, but to be a Hall of Famer has so much more to do with just football. There is really some great, great people in the Hall of Fame, and you get a chance to learn and know these guys as you get to be around them, and you understand why they made it this far, because they are such good people and solid citizens, as well as great athletes and guys who had tremendous work ethic, who had the great courage that we talk about, who always were looking for respect, were willing to put the commitment in to achieve that excellence that they were looking for. So all the different things that the Hall of Fame is all about, these guys all have within them, and I was just really fortunate to be a part of it.
All right, let's go to the back of the room again with a question. Your name and the school you represent, go ahead.
I'm Tamika Smith, and I go to Heritage Christian School. My question is, how did you feel after going undrafted, and how did that fuel your motivation?
Yeah, going undrafted, it was a bitter pill to swallow, because, you know, when most guys are looking forward to being drafted coming out of their senior year of college, I was looking whether I was even going to get a chance to play any more football after college. And if it wasn't for the Canadian Football League giving me that chance to play quarterback, who knows what would have happened with the rest of my career? Because I probably wouldn't have gone into the National Football League at another position. I just didn't feel like I was a good enough athlete to make a change that late in my career at the pro level, to be able to play wide receiver, which I had never played before, to play defensive back, which I had never played before. I just didn't feel like I would make it in the league, so why even try? I might as well go back and finish school and take another route. But the Canadian Football League gave me that opportunity, and like I said, I was bitter because I wasn't getting a chance to play the game in a country where I lived and in a league where I had a dream to play. But you got to go with the opportunities that are put in front of you, and I went with the best opportunity I had, which was in Canada, and I made the most of that opportunity and finally, you know, got a chance to play in the National Football League.
Thank you for your question. Thank you. Let's go back to our video conference from Warrensville Heights Middle School. They have another question for you, Warren. Go ahead, Warrensville Heights.
Go ahead. I'm Devani Halton from Warrensville Heights Middle School, and I have a question. As a child, what event in your life do you believe helped shape you into the man you are today?
I think the passing of my dad, that whole situation really kind of helped change my life and give me a lot of focus. You know, when you lose a parent that young in life, and you happen to be the only man in the house or the only male in the house at that particular time, there's no way I was a man at 7 years old. But I really matured a lot faster than most kids my age. My nickname when I was in junior high school was Pops, believe it or not, because I worried about everybody else. I was always asking people, you make sure you're prepared for class. I remember when I met my girlfriend, who ended up being my wife, in high school. We were gonna take a math test. We were in the same math class, and we hadn't met each other before, and she asked me for a pencil because she didn't have a pencil that day to take her math test. And I gave her the pencil, and I told her, you need to come to class prepared. You need to have the right materials and things when you come to class. These are the things I used to tell people all the time, because that's just kind of how meticulous I was about everything that I did at a very, very young age. And I think that particular situation with my dad dying and me taking on this big responsibility, and my mom will tell you today, she wished she would have never told me I was the man of the house at that particular age, because she didn't feel like I really had as much fun as a young kid as I probably should have, because I took on all this responsibility a little bit too seriously at such a young age in my life.
But as we've come to find out, it probably helped shape you as the man you are today, and one of the reasons you're right here in Canton.
Exactly. I don't think I become the man I am, or I'm not sitting on this stage if those events probably wouldn't have happened.
Let's go to the back of the room with another question. Your name, school, and then the question.
My name is Ezekiel Ford. I'm from Sandusky High School. And my question is, what would be your best piece of advice to an individual who is trying to overcome adversity?
I think my best advice, first of all, I need to know what that adversity was, but because I think there's all different types, and you know, there's different advice for different types of adversity that you're going through. But I think the main thing is always stay in focus of who you are and what you believe in. We're all gonna go through different adversities in our lives. A lot of you are probably going through adversities in your life right now. You're gonna go through even more as you move forward, but it's how you handle that adversity and how you attack that adversity. And a lot of it has to do with the confidence you have in yourself, the type of self-esteem that you have about yourself. And then again, if it has to do with work ethic, I think if it's something to do with maybe failure or whatever that adversity has to do with, you work a little bit harder at whatever it is. Again, not knowing what that adversity is, it's really hard for me to tell you exactly, you know, how to handle it. But in my case, my adversity had to do with people telling me that I couldn't do something that I knew that I could do. And the only way I knew how to handle that adversity was to go out and prove to not only myself, but prove to others that I could do it. And the only way to do that was to go out and work and become the best football player that I could become, where there was no question that anybody could ever say that I wasn't good enough to play that particular position. But when it comes to other adversity, it just depends on what that adversity is. But in my particular case, that's what it had to do with. And I would have different advice based off of whatever I thought that adversity was.
Thank you for your question. I want to go back to something you said, that you didn't feel you could make the switch at that point in your career from playing quarterback to another position. But correct me if I'm wrong, I think a good friend of yours, James Lofton, mm-hmm. was a high school quarterback.
Right.
And they wanted him to change positions and not be a quarterback because he was a great athlete. They wanted him to switch to wide receiver, and he did.
Right.
And you guys were good friends back in the day, and now you're both here in the Hall of Fame in Canton, but you took different paths. Do you guys ever talk about that?
We talk about it all the time because James and I were on the same Pop Warner football team in Los Angeles, California. And I don't think there's two other Hall of Famers that were on the same high school or Pop Warner football team growing up that ended up being here in Canton. So that's something that we have a distinction. It's a great trivia question if anybody ever wants to ask what two players were on the same Pop Warner football team that ended up in the Pro Football Hall of Fame. And James was a tremendous athlete. He was a quarterback in college. He was an all-city quarterback with me as well. But when he went to Stanford, they changed him to wide receiver, and he made that change. He was also a great track athlete, a great long jumper, a great quarter miler, and he had no problems making that change. I'm sure in the beginning he probably did, but he went ahead and made the change because he was a good enough athlete to do it. Again, I didn't feel like I was a great athlete. I was a good athlete for a quarterback, but I wasn't a great athlete in order to make that type of change. But we went different paths, but we ended up in the same place. And it just goes to show that if you're willing to go along with whatever opportunity that you're given, as long as you don't get down on that opportunity, as long as you stay positive, as long as you continue to work, you have a chance to be as good or maybe one of the best to ever play a position or one of the best to ever do whatever it is that you want to do, as long as you keep your eye on the prize and keep working hard.
All right, let's go to the back of the room with another question for Warren Moon. Go ahead, your name and the school you represent.
My name is Nathan Doak. I'm from Sandusky High School, and my question is, looking back on your career, what are you most proud of?
I think I talked about it earlier. I think I'm most proud that I was able to help make change for more African Americans to play the quarterback position at the pro level than what we had prior to my playing days. And again, I think because of the way myself played, I think the way Doug Williams played and winning a Super Bowl, that dispelled that an African American couldn't win the biggest game of the year. The way Randall Cunningham performed, he was an MVP one year, very exciting player that played at a very high level. And the way I played over the course of my career, we helped make that change to give more African Americans more of an opportunity. So I think that's the thing I'm most proud of, that we were able to make change and give more guys more opportunities.
Thank you for your question. Do we have any other further questions as we begin winding down the program here today? Step up to the microphone. Again, your name, the school you represent, your question for Warren.
My name is Andrew Wade. I'm from Heritage Christian School. You have done work for various charities such as the Special Olympics, the Ronald McDonald House, and the American Heart Association. Why do you think it is important to volunteer your time to those in need?
I think I talked about that a little bit too. My mother had a lot to do with that. Just watching her as a very giving person. We didn't have a whole lot, but whatever she had, she offered to others, whether it was people in our neighborhood, any kid that came over our house, she always had something to offer them. If there was a family in the neighborhood that needed a meal or whatever, she'd cook meals for them. Whatever it was that she could do, she just had a very giving heart. And again, a lot of that rubbed off on me watching her. And once I got to a point where my career started to take off and I had a little bit more status, I felt like I had an opportunity to make a difference and change in other people's lives as well on a bigger level. So I established a foundation when I was in Houston called the Crescent Moon Foundation. And we've been in existence now since 1989. And education has always been something big in my house because everybody can't be a professional athlete. Everybody can't be a movie star. Everybody can't be a professional singer. But if you have a chance to be educated, then you have a chance to maybe be successful in life. And so what our foundation mainly does is provide scholarships to underprivileged high school kids to go to college. And we've been doing this, like I said, since 1989, but we also work with a lot of other charities like Ronald McDonald House or like St. Jude Hospital, Children's Hospital. And I'm all about giving young kids an opportunity to realize their dreams. And the only way you can do that, for one, you have to be healthy. You've got to have good health. So I try and be around charities that help young kids with health issues. And I also try and give kids opportunities to further their education. And I think if you have health and you're educated, then you have a chance to be successful in life. So that's where a lot of my giving comes from, my mom. And I've just kind of taken it to another level because of the status that I have as a football player. It gives me a great stage in order to, and a great platform in order to get my message out there and also to encourage people to give. And along with my giving of my time and my money, it also inspires other people to give as well. So it's been a very successful thing for me, a very heartfelt thing for me, and something I've really taken on to another level since I retired from football and have a lot more time to spend on it.
Thanks for your question. Any other questions in the back? We've got one more. All right, we have time for it. Step on up. Your name and the school you represent, please.
I'm Ben Price. I'm from Heritage Christian School. Which NFL player, past or present, do you most look up to and why?
Wow. There are so many great football players, so many great football people. It's really kind of hard to single out one. I know one guy that was in my class, believe it or not, who passed away before he was actually inducted. Reggie White was a guy I had a tremendous amount of respect for. Because of the way he played the game, he could dominate a game almost by himself on the defensive side of the ball, on the defensive line. One of those guys you always had to worry about when you game planned against him, how you were going to block him. You know, were you going to put a tight end on the same side of him? Were you going to chip him with a back, double team him, whatever it might be to try and slow him down, which allowed other people to make a lot of great plays. He was like a gentle giant. When he was on the field, he was one way, but off the field, what a gentle guy he was, a man of God, always trying to get players to do the right thing. Just a really, really good person, and was very sad to hear of his passing, but honored to be in the same Pro Football Hall of Fame class with him in 2006. So he was probably one of the guys I had a tremendous amount of respect for, but there's so many others that have played the game over the years.
Thank you for your question.
Thank you.
Warren, before we let you get out of here, just some final words for the students and everybody else in the audience today.
Well, first of all, I just want to thank you guys all for coming out today. I know there wasn't a whole lot of you that knew a lot about who I was coming into this. I know there's a lot of athletes in the room. A lot of you guys have big dreams and desires to be successful in life. Those of you who don't want to be athletes, I'm sure there are other aspirations that you want to prescribe to be when you grow up. And I just want you to know that everything that you want to do in your life is in front of you. You have the ability to be whatever you want to be in life, and I'm a perfect example of that. Does that mean it's going to be easy? No, it's not. You're going to have adversity. You're going to go through some tough times. You're going to have to go through hurdles. You know, people are going to tell you you're not good enough. You're going to have doors closed in your face from time to time. Everything is not going to be rosy. But as long as you believe in your ability, as long as you put the work ethic in that it takes to be successful, and as long as you have people around you that are helping push you and motivate you, I think you have a chance to be whatever it is you want to be. But you can't get down when times get a little bit low and a little bit tough. You can't give up. You've got to continue to persevere through. And that's where you've got to be even tougher is when you are dealing with tough times. Because you've heard that old saying, tough times make tough people. Well, you have to be a product of that. And I was a product of that. I could have really got down on the doors that were closed in my face, the things that I didn't get an opportunity to do, but I didn't let that deter me. Sure, it made me bitter. Sure, it made me sad at times, no question about it. But I continued to just keep trugging along and keep working. And I felt like one day, somewhere, somehow, I was going to get that opportunity. And I think you have to look at it the same way. As long as you continue to keep working, as long as you keep your eye on the prize, as long as you set your goals for yourself and continue to hit those goals as you move along in your life, you have a chance to be successful and do anything that you possibly want to do. and always have a backup plan, because I knew if I didn't make it in football, I wanted to go to law school and I wanted to be a lawyer. So always have that backup plan based off of what it is you want to do in your life. So if things don't go the way you want them to, say in athletics or something like that, you always have that education to fall back on, because the most important thing you can do in your life right now is to get your education. Your education will allow you to always be able to get a job and be successful in life. What I was able to do as a football player is kind of an extracurricular activity that I turned into a profession. And I was very fortunate to be able to get to this level, but I also made sure that I did a good job in school, that I would always have that to fall back on if things didn't work well for me as an athlete. So for you athletes out there, don't put all your eggs in one basket. Make sure you continue to get your education. For those of you who are students out there, continue to work hard at class and whatever your major is that you want to try and aspire to, and just put the work in. If you put the work in, you'll get the results out, I guarantee you. And I just want to wish all of you the best of luck in your lives. You've got everything, like I said, in front of you. And I was in this same seat many, many years ago, listening to other different people talk, you know, about what it takes to be successful, and I'm glad I listened. And hopefully you guys are taking advantage of this opportunity. And it doesn't mean everything that I have to say is the absolute right thing, but I guarantee you some of the things I've had to talk about have worked for me, and I think they've worked for others, and I think they can work for you if you take out of what I've had to say today and apply it to whatever it is you're going after in your life. So the best of luck to all of you, and God bless all of you. Thank you very much.
Warren, thanks so much. Appreciate it. Warren has another event he's got to get to right now, so we thank him for spending time with us today here as we celebrate Black History Month, persevering through adversity. As he said, hopefully you'll be able to take something away from what he shared with you today and apply it to your lives. Thanks once again for coming out. Travel safely and have a great day. So long.